My name is Abby Schmiedt, and I'm a software engineer at Google, where I work on the Blocky team. Over the past couple of years, we have talked a lot about moving away from a model where developers fork Blocky and directly modify parts of core. One of the questions that generally arises when we talk about this is, how am I going to create this awesome new feature without modifying core? In this talk, I'm going to go through some different ways developers can customize Blocky using our provided APIs. I won't go through all of them, but I'm planning to point out some resources and common patterns that will hopefully give you a starting place when creating your next awesome feature.
So first up, we're going to talk about plugins. So plugins are a great first place to look to see if the feature you want has already been created. If you want to browse the plugins, I would recommend heading over to the Blocky Samples GitHub IO page. On this page, we have all of our plugins, and when you click on each plugin, you can see a playground where you can play around with the plugin, and also there's a README, which shows you different ways that you can customize the plugin further. So for example, on the field grip dropdown page, you can change the number of columns, the primary color, or the border color for the plugin. So next up, we're going to be talking about inject options. So this is probably the most straightforward way to configure Blocky. These are a set of options that you can change when you first create the Blocky workspace. The inject options are pretty well documented, so I'm going to skim over these a bit, but there's a link to the documentation in these slides. If you prefer a more hands-on approach to testing out the options, you can go to the advanced playground and see these options updated in real time. All right, so next up is injecting a class. This is definitely a more heavyweight way to customize Blocky, but it also provides you with a lot of freedom. We offer a subset of classes that can be overridden or completely replaced. The list of these classes can be found on the Using Blocky APIs page. If the class you want to change is in this list, you can either extend from our base class or completely substitute in your own class that implements the corresponding interface. If you end up extending the base class, you can use anything that is public or protected in that class. When subclassing, we highly recommend that you try your hardest to not copy and paste large chunks of code from the base class into your class. Doing so will make it more difficult to maintain in the future. When this is not possible, feel free to leave us an issue or a forum post describing what you are trying to do and why it is not working. Once you have created your class, you can simply add it to the inject options and you're all set. Where we were previously using our class, we will instead use your class. If you're planning on using json.stringify to save your inject options, you can register your class and use the name you registered under instead in the inject options. Okay, so next up, we're going to be talking about registries. So registries come up quite a bit in our documentation when looking at how to customize Blocky, so I wanted to spend some time talking about the different ways we use them. We generally use registries for two reasons. The first being what we just talked about, which is to be able to go from a class or object to a string that can be used in a definition that you as the developer are creating. For example, you can register custom fields so that they can be used in your JSON block definitions. Similarly, you can register toolbox items so that they can be used in either a JSON or XML toolbox definition, and you can register injected classes so that they can be used in the inject options. The key here being that when you register items that fall in this category, it is up to you to use these items. We won't do anything internally with these definitions unless you use them in some kind of definition. The second way we use registries is that we take some collection of objects that you have provided us with, and we use that information internally to make decisions. So that's a bit broad, but for example, the context menu registry takes in an object, and then we use those properties on the object to make decisions about when we should show your context menu item, where it should be placed in the menu, and what action should be run when a user clicks on the item. The key here is that all you have to do for this to work is to register your item. So now that we know a bit more about registries, I'm going to dive into a few concrete examples. Okay, so first up, we are going to be taking a look at the context menu API. The context menu is displayed when a user right-clicks on a block or on a workspace. The context menu registry lets you add and remove custom context menu items. So all you have to do in order to add a new context menu item is create an object with all the necessary properties on it and register it. More information on the properties required can be found in the context menu registry documentation linked on this site. We have a default set of context menu items that can also be removed by unregistering them. The keyboard shortcut registry is very similar to the context menu registry. It allows developers to run action when certain keys have been pressed. The difference here is that once you've registered your shortcut, you also need to create a serialized key with information about any modifier keys that should be used with the primary key. Once you have a serialized key code, you can add that key mapping into the registry. Multiple key mappings can be added for each shortcut. So, shifting away from registries a bit, the other way developers can customize Blocky is by setting functions directly on a class or namespace. The most recent example of this is the new tooltip API that Maribeth added in version 8 of Blocky. Developers can change the look of the tooltip that shows up when a block is moused over by creating a function that takes in the div where the tooltip will be rendered and the element that is being moused over. You can then pass this function into the setCustomTooltip function. So next up is events. I think events are often overlooked as a way to customize Blocky, but you can actually do quite a bit by listening to events. Events are also well documented on our developer page, but if you'd rather play around with them, you can go to the Advanced Playground, scroll down to the Action section, and look under and toggle the Log Events button. This will log any events emitted to the console. Just a reminder that the flyout is actually a different workspace, so if you would like to see what events are emitted in the flyout, you have to check the Log Flyout Events button. So I'm adding this last section mostly for completeness. Hopefully it is not a surprise that Blocky lets you create custom blocks, generators, and fields. All of these are pretty well documented, so I'm just going to add some links that will be helpful to look at. I will also note that the Blocky developer tools can be a bit difficult to get used to, but once you do, they are very helpful in figuring out what your blocks will look like. I left out quite a few APIs that are available for the sake of time, so I'm going to leave you with this. If you have looked through the documentation and are still having issues, feel free to ask on the developer forum. Our team or other active members on the forum can point you to a good place to start or let you know that you should create an issue for what you are looking for. And finally, sometimes there's not a great way to create the feature you want on top of Blocky. If that is the case, again, let us know. It's not always appropriate for us to create your exact feature in core samples, but if we know what you're trying to accomplish, we can try and create an API that will at least allow you to do what you want without having to fork Blocky. So finally, thank you all for your time.